Good morning. Welcome to the February 17th session of the Fish and Wildlife Commission. I'm Harold Cannon. I'll be chairing today's meeting. For five of us, this will be our last meeting. And so we're going to savor the moment. And as part of that, I've asked my wife to do the invocation. One of the things when a husband and wife work together is that she doesn't get to attend many of these things. And trust me, if you got to know her, you'd prefer that she be up here. But it's a privilege to have her. So Angie, if you'd lead us with the invocation and pledge, please.
Father, we praise you for the majesty all around us, for the beauty you have blessed this state with. You have told us in your word that the mountains and the hills will praise you, and even the rocks will cry out if we don't. So Lord, that's what we're doing. We bring you our praise. We bring you our love and our admiration for all the blessings you've given us and the beauty that you have surrounded us with. I thank you for these men and women of this agency and the staff who day after day protect this beauty for us all to enjoy. I pray for their safety, Lord. I pray also for the safety of our troops, Lord, that are serving all over the world and some in very dangerous situations, to also give us this blessing of living in this state and the beauty around us and the freedoms that we have. I pray, Lord, for these commissioners who have been given the honor of managing these beautiful resources. And Lord, we pray for wisdom and discernment as they strive to represent all of us in this great state of Tennessee. And we pray these things in your son's name. Amen.
So much. I appreciate it. Danette, would you mind calling the roll, please?
Jim Bledsoe.
Here.
Chad Baker.
Here.
Jeff Cook.
Here.
Bill Cox.
Here.
Kurt Holbert.
Here.
Connie King.
Here.
Jeff McMillan.
Here.
Jim Ripley.
Here.
Bill Swan.
Here.
Trey Teague.
Here.
David Watson.
Here.
Jamie Woodson. Harold Cannon.
Here.
Chairman, we have a quorum.
Danette, thank you for your faithful service, for Barbara's service prior to you. You've been remarkable.
Thank you.
Remarkably patient, and you won't get as many calls from me from here on out, so thanks so much. You're right. Commissioners, before we get into the formal welcome, you have been provided the minutes from our last meeting. Are there any comments or corrections?
Move they be approved, Mr. Ripley.
Commissioner Swan moves for approval. Do I have a second?
Second.
Have a second from Commissioner Ripley. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. The minutes are approved. Again, we want to welcome everyone to today's commission meeting. When Angie and I had the privilege to take grandkids down to Disney, one of the things we saw, and I'll butcher it well, but the gist of it was is that what we're being given the opportunity to do is take care of the resources that we're actually borrowing from the next generation. I believe that this commission is leaving it in much better shape for that next generation. And so that's what we're about today, is being stewards of those resources. Contrary to any rumors that you may have heard, the five of us are not dead yet. We are still active until the end of this month and plan to be so. So please feel free to holler at us. I am going to ask that, if you would, as we go into today's session, it may get a little long because we do have a full agenda. And we're not going to rush things. We have too many important things to be covered today. But in order for us to do that well, I do ask that you silent or turn off your cell phone so that that's not a distraction. Many of you will get a call while you're in here, as will we. And if that's a call you really need to take, please go outside. We understand. And there's no offense somebody having to walk out. But please go outside, just out of respect to everyone else here. And that's the other foundational element of this meeting. We have worked very, very hard for the 6 years I've been on, for the 8 years that Commissioner McMillan has been on, to treat everyone with respect. We ask for that same respect. We may disagree, but contrary to the way some things are in the political circles, I believe we can do that respectfully. And so that's how we're going to conduct ourselves. If you do have a comment, we ask you to come up to the mic, give us your name, your address. You're not going to be checked out, just so that we have that as part of the record. We do ask that you speak either to myself or the chair of the committee that the matter is coming before at that time. We'll direct the proper staff. That just makes things flow smoother. Likewise, we'd like you to do your best to limit the comments to 3 minutes. We're flexible there, but at the same time, if it gets repetitive, I will very respectfully ask you to summarize it. But I will ask you to summarize it. Commissioners, are there any comments that you have before we get into the agenda? Director Carter, any comments?
No, sir. Thank you.
If not, then excuse me just a second. I'm messing myself up here. I believe we go to Chairman Teague, Chair of the Wildlife Management Committee. Floor is yours, sir. My apologies, I goofed. Michael May, who's Chief of our Information Technology, I believe we have a presentation to make.
Actually says lunch.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate that. The IT Professional of the Year Award is very important to us. It's not an award that gets passed around to the next person in line. It's we've had several people who received the quarterly awards multiple times and several who have not. And those who have not are mentored in the criteria and what they need to do to move forward and make that achievement. And I appreciate the support of the commission and the director's office with this endeavor, as it has become a very sought after achievement in the IT division. Which ultimately provides the best possible product for the agency, so thank you. And so the criteria that we look at, and just a few of the line items, we looked at consistent quality production as a subject matter expert in their discipline, engage in and promote a healthy and functional team environment, work towards viable solutions that save the agency money, and work towards honing leadership skills. And if that individual is a supervisor or in a lead position, then they need to mentor their subordinates for succession. So all that's taken into account. And our quarterly award winners for 2016 were Unika Bush out of data entry, Brian Sands out of the help desk team, Zainab Latif out of the programming team, and Jeff Green, our network administrator. And our annual award winner goes to Zainab Latif. And I'd like to read the citation, if I may take a moment. Zainab Latif distinguished herself by exceptional service as a lead programmer analyst for the Information Technology Division of the Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agency. During her tenure, Zainab was a lead program analyst responsible for designing, coding, modifying, and implementing new programming applications. She also consistently performed as a mentor at an exceptional level. She provided extensive leadership and guidance in programming development to the remainder of the group. Her method of mentoring stimulates a positive and productive team environment by encouraging valuable input from her other members, thus promoting inclusiveness and ideas and confidence in abilities. Zainab displays patience and understanding regardless of the complexity of the situation. The additional attention applied to these areas often requires extra time and effort, but never prevents her from completing her assigned projects with exceptional quality and by deadline. Additionally, Zainab developed a public-facing application for the Hunters Agency's Hunter Safety Education Program. This application is used by the public to search for and find additional educational courses offered throughout the state. Agency personnel use the application to post classes, manage the instructor and student rosters, as well as the training locations. The implementation of Zainab's Hunter Safety Program replaces a service that we previously provided from a vendor and will now save the agency at least $50,000 annually. Her new application also exceeds the overall functionality, administration efficiency, and intuitive user experience over the previous version. Moreover, Zainab accomplished all the aforementioned responsibilities with a keen sense of true professionalism and expert attention to quality while providing the highest level of genuinely courteous and heartfelt customer service. The distinctive accomplishments of Zainab Latif reflect great credit upon herself, the Information Technology Division, the Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agency, and the state of Tennessee. And I'd like to present Zainab Latif. And her supervisor, Wilma Newsom.
Again, congratulations. And I must be nervous up here because I'm looking at the itinerary, at the agenda for the day, and the next thing there's a note that talks about lunch, and I'm going, it's not time for lunch yet. And I just overlooked Teague's down here voting for lunch. Go figure. Overruled for right now, anyway. Commission recognizes Chairman Trey Teague, who chairs the Wildlife Management Committee. Trey, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman Cannon. I'm going to ask Jamie Federson to come back and give us a very brief recap of our migratory bird game season.
Thank you, Chairman Teague. So yesterday you saw my presentation. I'm not going to go through it again, but essentially we're asking you to approve the recommendations we have for Proclamation 17-01, which deals with the early migratory game bird hunting seasons. The only change that we have in that, it establishes the season dates, but there is one change that would shift the woodcock season 2 weeks later to begin on the second Saturday in November. And then the other proposal that I presented to you yesterday was for the late season migratory bird seasons, which includes ducks, geese, and cranes. The only change that established hunting season dates, the only changes that we proposed in that were for decreasing the bag limit of northern pintails from 2 to 1 and increasing the bag limit of American black ducks from 1 to 2. And then we also asked about the expansion of the sandhill crane season to include statewide tags be issued. So at this point, those are the proposals we have for you to approve.
Chairman Cannon, yesterday the Wildlife Management Committee voted and I moved to approve Proclamation 17-01 and 17-02. Which I believe we have to do separate in a vote, but
we'll do a separate vote on those if that's all right. The first will be 1701. Coming from committee, I'll take that as a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second from Commissioner Bledsoe. Is there any discussion within the commission?
I think we need to discuss moving that woodcock season to Saturday. That's pretty important. How many woodcock hunters do we have in our state? I just wanted to be able to talk about something today. So.
And we're glad you do, Commissioner McMahon.
There's two, aren't there? So, nah, we'll be okay. We'll move it to Saturday.
Is there any other discussion? Any discussion from the public? We're happy to discuss woodcock season. I mean, you know, we're here for you. Hearing none, all in favor of the proclamation as presented, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. Proclamation 17-01 passes. Commissioner Teague, 17-02.
Yes, make a motion. Well, the Wildlife Committee voted and I recommend.
Wildlife Committee voted and I recommend passage of Proclamation 17-02.
He rattled you, didn't he? He got me too. That's.
I was looking for, see if he had anything over here, but he seems to be just naturally confused. I think this is all natural.
I'm taking that as a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner McMillan. Any discussion on the commission? Commissioner McMillan?
No, I'm good.
Are you good? Okay. That's good. That's any from staff or the public? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. Proclamation 17-02 passes. Thank you, Commissioner Teague. Appreciate it. Before we're about to go into a rulemaking hearing. Before we do that, Commissioner McMillan's family's in the back. Come on in. You don't have to stand up through this. We have Commissioner Bledsoe's family here, my wife. Or if he starts talking, you have to talk over him. That's the key to that.
Sorry, the valet lost. We were with Connie, and the valet lost our keys.
Uh-huh.
Maybe they couldn't understand you because you can't talk.
Yep, it's going to be a cold night at the McMillan household. Okay.
I'm
going to
stay in trouble all day, I'm going to tell.
We are going to go into a rulemaking hearing at this time. This is a rulemaking hearing before the Tennessee Fish and Wildlife Commission to consider the following rules. A new rule, 1660-01-32, which deals with the rules and regulations for species that are in need of management, threatened or endangered, and the repeal of rule 1660-03-01, which deals with rules and regulations for access to public records. My name is Harold Cannon. I will conduct this hearing. This is the order of the proceedings. Tennessee Fish Wildlife Resource Agency staff will present information regarding the proposed rules. Commission members will be permitted to comment and ask questions. Members of the audience will be permitted to comment and ask questions. Staff members and members of the audience wishing to speak should identify themselves before speaking. I reserve the right to limit comments and discussion, particularly in the case of repetition. We will now consider a new rule 1660-01-32, which deals with species that are in need of management, threatened or endangered. The commission recognizes Jamie Woodson, chair of the Biodiversity Multiple Use Committee. Chairman Woodson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to ask Bill Reeves to join us to share about the rule 1660-01-32.
Thank you, Commissioner Woodson.
Thank you.
I have a brief PowerPoint. Commissioner Cox always likes to comment on my
thing.
So, and I have to apologize right up front because we need to go over what's in the Code of Tennessee to inform you, if you haven't read it, and to inform the audience of what the code says so that we know how to act from that point forward. So, but I'll be as brief as possible. So, in 1973, Congress passed the Endangered Species Act. In 1974, the legislature of Tennessee passed this act. And it was last amended in 2000, but in 2000, we as an agency mistakenly had it as a proclamation. So in August, we were informed of that fact, and we began the process of developing this into a rule, which we are here today to cover. Well, I've not used this version of PowerPoint before. So, these are the statements in the rule, in the code, that relate to why we are here today. And, pardon me while I put my glasses on. So, we can skip 70-8-101. That's just the title, the declaration, is NO2, has some things in it that we need to cover. And keep in mind, you have to keep in mind that this was following the Federal Endangered Species Act, the very year after. So a lot of this is repetitious of what is in the Federal Act. Particularly number 2, species and subspecies, keep that in mind as we go forward because that has implications at the federal level. And the number 3, assist in the protection of endangered and threatened species, a key word in that one is assist. This is a reflection of what we should do to help implement the federal regulation. We have no authority over the federal regulation or law, obviously, but we are to assist them in making it happen. And Commissioner Cox, number 4, I thought of you when I saw that, because we were supposed to, in 74, seek funding from the general fund. I wasn't here.
Did you say he was a commissioner then?
So 103 just covers the definitions in the act. 104 gets down to a little more of who's supposed to do what. So the executive director shall conduct investigations by way of staff, of course. And on the basis of such determinations, the Wildlife Resources Agency or Commission shall issue proposed regulations no later this in April 1975. So 75 was the first time there was anything in place. And such regulations shall set forth species and subspecies of non-game wildlife that the executive director deems in need of management. And that's where, if you noticed in the rule, we have that section in need of management. That's where that comes from. The commission shall, by such regulations, establish proposed limitations related to habitat alteration, taking, possession, transportation, exportation. That's got to be straight out of the federal code. We've never done that. We don't have the ability to do it. We don't have the funding to do that. Except as provided in regulations issued by the commission, it is unlawful for any person to take, attempt to take, possess. Those words are straight out of the federal code as well. Subject to the same exception is also unlawful for any common or contract carrier knowingly to transport or receive of shipment of non-game wildlife. We've never dealt with that either. So in 105, it gets down to exactly who's supposed to do what, and in B, it outlines what the commission needs to do, and every 2 years, review the list, make changes as appropriate, and then implement those changes. And then the director's supposed to submit them to the governor. And number C is where we have the federal species listed in our rule, because C pretty much says that we're supposed to. So those are the guidelines. There are other sections in that same act, but they just clarify other parts of it, and we don't need to go into those. So the mission of what we do in the Biodiversity Division comes from the federal funding that we receive, and we do these two things. We downlist or delist endangered species at the federal level. We work toward that. Or we work toward those species that are state species that are approaching federal listing, and we try to prevent their listing. And this rule provides us a guidepost. That list basically tells us what we need to work on. So a little comparison between the Federal Endangered Species Act and what this rule provides. And I've outlined the federal on the left and the state on the right, but basically the things listed there under, we cannot do anything that's listed on the left, and that's basically the Endangered Species Act. So our rule separates itself from the Endangered Species Act with all of those things. And as an example, we have just down the hill here in the creek, there's a federally listed endangered crayfish called the Nashville crayfish. The only place it exists on the planet is in Mill Creek, right through town. And I doubt most of you even realize that, because it just lives its happy little life in the creek, and it's not, except for some guidance that's provided by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, what you can do right up next to the creek. There's nothing else that goes on with that. It's one of those that just, it's federally listed, but it's not a problem. And changing the subject, I want you to know that we didn't gin this list up from nowhere. We gathered our list of experts together by email and by phone. We didn't get them all together in a room like we did for this, but it's the same people. So briefly, just to let you know, we did include all the experts in the state that we could get up with. Briefly go through, these are the people that advised us on the bird list, the aquatics list, fish, mussels, snails, and crayfish, the amphibians and reptiles, and the mammals. So, and to also give you an understanding that we don't just add species to the list. In this rule, we took these species out. And there are a lot of different reasons for that, but the primary reason for there being so many birds on there is these birds were put in initially in 74, 75. The EPA banned DDT, which caused all bird eggs to crush when the parent bird sat on them. And over the decades that followed, the birds have recovered, so they don't need to be on that list anymore. Now, let me give you a quick example of how we work with the species on this list. This is a little salamander. Well, it's not so little, it's kind of fat, but that occurs around Nashville, in the counties surrounding Nashville, and the housing development is eating up the habitat that this animal lives in. We're working with these agencies listed there to work with the developers, the willing private developers, to set their habitat aside in common areas and stuff like that, so that they're not running bulldozers through the streams, and they're not putting houses or culverts in there. So this is the status of this thing. It was petitioned by the Center for Biological Diversity to be listed under this what we call a mega suit that they won in federal court. And now the Fish and Wildlife Service has to decide what to do with these species. So we're helping to prevent the listing of these 404 species. That's as I said, that's part of our mission. So this species occurs, this is the range of this species, in the red. And you see in Tennessee, it's what we call a disjunct range, because at some time in the past, it was probably all connected, but it's not connected anymore. And this sets up a thought process of this is a subspecies, like was mentioned in the code. And it has been documented to be a subspecies, but it has to be brought to the federal level. If it is brought to the federal level, it will probably be listed. So here's what the habitat used to look like. In the background, you can see the Cedar Glade area, which used to surround the stream. This is a culvert that goes into a development area, and you can see the houses back behind the agency vehicle. and this is what it used to look like. The slab rocks you see in the foreground on the right are where these salamanders reproduce, and they reproduce under the rocks by attaching their eggs to the bottom of the rock, and the eggs turn into larvae, the larvae hatch, and then you repopulate the system. Well, if you have silted in rocks or the rocks removed, you don't have any more salamanders after one generation. And in this area of Nolensville, where we're currently working with those developers and the Corps of Engineers and all the state agencies, up in the upper left is what it used to look like in 75, where it was a pastoral area with forest, and in the right is what it looks like last year. The little red area is documented areas of streamside salamander. So you can see that development plays a part in this, and we need to work with the developers to improve the situation by creating common areas and stuff like that where the habitat, the riparian habitat and the stream habitat still exist. So that's it. You have on your iPad the rule and also the information packet about the species. We also have handouts, and we have a list of the peer review folks that helped put this new list together.
Madam Chairman, I have a question, if I may.
Yes, sir.
And I'm not sure whether to direct this to Mr. Reeves as much, maybe to legal counsel, but doesn't this all really boil down to a requirement that we simply list the species that are endangered or threatened?
I mean, in my opinion, that's correct, but you might want to check with Cheryl or Tracy about that.
You all concur with that? It just seems to me that, we can refer to the statute, but if we do what we're required to do, that is list the species, it might be a simpler way to approach the problem and possibly avoid opening all kinds of discussions and issues that we don't need to open.
I mentioned that a lot of that verbiage in the Code of Tennessee was taken directly from the Endangered Species Act. So it's a duplication, actually.
I saw that. I guess, Madam Chairman, if I may, I would make in the form of a motion that we simply amend the rule to be a list of those species that we are charged with protecting.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, if I might, go ahead and make the motion to pass the rule. And when you have your second, I think that this is a very appropriate amendment for the rule and would certainly support it, and will offer my second to it. So I'll make a motion on for consideration of the rule so you can get it properly before you.
Commissioner Woodson has made a motion for approval of the rule as presented. Do I have a second?
Second.
Have a second from Commissioner Hulbert. We have also had now an amendment presented by Commissioner Ripley to, if you will, simplify this rule. Council, I'm looking to you. Tell me what I'm...
Is there any other discussion?
Do you want to have discussion on the as presented? Okay.
Is there any discussion in the audience as presented?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you, Tracy.
No, there's any discussion.
I have a motion for amending...
Yeah, my motion, I move to amend the rule such that it simply sets out a list of the species that we're charged with protecting.
Do I have a second to that amendment?
Second.
I have a second from Commissioner Bledsoe. We will now take any comments or discussion from the commission on both matters, both the rule as presented and the amendment. Let the record reflect that we did check with council. Council concurs that the simplification to this rule is an acceptable amendment. Are there any comments?
I have a question.
Commissioner Cox.
I'm looking at the list on the back page of ours, and the proclamation number of species and the rule number of species for state endangered and federal endangered, et cetera, is our list, the state list, different from the federal list? I mean, how do we list something that the feds do not? Are we stricter on something than they're not?
No, and that's why I use the Streamside salamander. The feds will only list that if it's a subspecies. It's been documented to be a subspecies, but not in the peer review literature. So we're putting it on our list so that it becomes an attention point, I wrote Commissioner Goodson and used the analogy of a flashing yellow light along the highway at night. It's a beacon that says, you better do something about this or the feds are going to list it. So that's why we put it on there and others. Now, the Fed list is much longer than this. It includes marine mammals. It includes species around the world. And the Fed list that we have in there, the species from the Fed list, are only those that are applicable to Tennessee.
Well, my concern is, while I don't disagree that there's some protection needed for endangered and threatened species, that and you use the example of the development that's going on, that we may be holding development to a higher standard than the federal statutes require.
Well, we're not.
We're doing things more than what the U.S. Fish and Wildlife would do if they were in charge of it. So I'm concerned that we're, you know.
First of all, we're only working with willing developers. There will be those that say, I don't want to work with you, and then we go away.
So our requirement that this salamander, if that developer does not want to spend an extra $50,000 to do what you think he needs to do, there's no requirement that he do that.
Correct.
Unless it's federally listed.
Unless it's federally listed, and then he has to go into consultation with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and sit around a table and describe how he's going to prevent the extinction of that species. And we don't have those kind of meetings.
Forgive me, and I'm going to, Commissioner Cox, if I can piggyback on what you've just asked. You all know by now, after 12 months, how slow I am. My understanding of this rulemaking hearing is to bring us into compliance with the federal requirements, which includes the federal listing of species that are endangered. I'll use the wrong terminology, but just stay with me, Bill.
Yeah.
My question's very basic. Have we added any other species to this list that is not listed currently by the feds?
Yes. And this goes back to the code where it says we need to have a list of in need of management species. There's no such thing in the federal list. They have different terminology and different guidance, even though some of the same species may be on it. But they have an at-risk list that's the lowest level, which are still state species. You need to understand the distinction between a federal species and a state species. We have
Mr. Reeves,
no authority over states or federal species.
Commissioner Woodson is recognized.
Thank you, Bill. This has been very helpful. And this is an issue that as I have been reading this, and I very much appreciate the simplification language on the amendment that Commissioner Ripley has suggested, I do think that this has potentially significant implications. And to the extent that we can further review the difference between the federal list and Tennessee's list, and each commissioner, including our new colleagues, will have a full appreciation. I might just make the motion to table this to our next meeting and hear it at that time, if that's all right with both legal and my colleagues.
I'll second that.
I have a
So, Commissioner Ripley, if I understand you correctly, I'm just making sure the public who's watching this will get this. You're wanting to take everything out of the rule except the actual list of these species. So that would mean you would be deleting paragraph 3 at the bottom of page 6, and you would be deleting paragraphs 2 through 4 on page 9.
Man, I don't,
I've misplaced my draft of this.
Well, I'll show it to you.
I was looking at what I could on the computer, but let me see. Yeah, essentially.
Yeah, and